Professor, you know, I take your point on that about, you know, about his relations. But if one were to talk about the body language, you know, Trudeau's had a bad year. You know, all of this comes out just right after the G20. We saw what happened in the G20. There was this widespread impression that Trudeau was, you know, sulking. He wasn't in a very good mood. He was being cold-shouldered, etc., etc. And that everything that has followed since then, including him naming India now in Canadian Parliament, actually springs from a personal sense of frustration and having to prove a point. What do you think about that?
Again, I think we can contextualize this in a longer history of Justin Trudeau's social faux pas. So remember, his last visit to India was not problem-free. His, you know, his public dancing, his odd behavior during that visit, you know, all point to someone who really doesn't have a very adult sense of judgment, rather than to somebody who has a nefarious plan of some kind. You know, I think he's a person who simply doesn't have a really good compass, who is being influenced by people in his party and in his coalition partnership, the NDP in Canada, who have their own very strong, very well thought through interests. That is, I think it's more likely to see Justin Trudeau as a lightweight tool of people who have their own agenda, rather than to see some agenda on his own part.
Another aspect of this, Professor, is, you know, our reports that Justin Trudeau came to the G20 after having failed, quote-unquote, failed to rally his five I partners, which includes the United States and Australia. What do you make of that? Because no one wants to oversimplify a complicated matter, but there is a sense that some of these countries which have independent relationships and independent and expanding relationships, might I say, with India, have refused to get on to that Trudeau wagon as far as unifying and somehow condemning India on this issue where there's no evidence.
The Anglosphere press is very gullible. One hopes that the Anglosphere intelligence agencies are not so gullible. Canada may be culturally an important partner for the Anglosphere. Militarily, it is not very important. I think it's worth noting that Canada is a Pacific country, yet it has not been invited to join the Quad, and there's been no mention of it. Canada is a longtime ally of the U.S. and United Kingdom, yet it was not invited to join the AUKUS alliance as Australia was. So Canada is not as well integrated into Western defense establishments as, well, I think as many Westerners would like it to be or expect it to be. It has a position more akin to that of New Zealand in the sense of being nominally part of Western alliance structures, but widely perceived as not being doing enough for its own defense or for the broader defense of the Western world. So I think the defense and security establishments are probably less gullible, less likely to take a Canadian prime minister's word at face value than is the press. The press has swallowed this hook, line, and sinker. And again, I want to stress, we don't know what happened, but we've not been presented, not only have we not been presented with any evidence, we haven't even been presented with a clear claim by the Canadian prime minister, which is to say that all of his accusations have been couched in a language of possibility, not in a language of certainty. And I think that's something we can all, you know, read our own message into.
My last question to you, Professor, is, there has been one section which is talking about how this may not be Canada-specific at all. It could be a grand conspiracy for regime change in India. We do know that there are elections in India next year as well. What do you make of that? Would you dismiss something like that? Would you see a larger design as far as regime change is concerned?
Not conspiracy in the sense of a group of people acting together, but the effectiveness of a kind of cooperation, if not collaboration, in the sense that, you know, the Western media are very skeptical of India. They are goaded into that skepticism by an aggressive international Islamist media, by human rights activists, by Sikh rights activists. All of these groups have been trying to get the Western media on board with an anti-India agenda. The best India gets in the major Western media is a suspension of condemnation, which is to say that there are figures at major Western news outlets who will say that India is too important to isolate or too important not to work with. That's not the same as them having a strong faith in India's democratic institutions. It's very hard to find that kind of faith anywhere in the Western media.